amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life. That I would be set free. That you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory. Who brings our nations with truth and justice? Shines with the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory. Above all kings, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life. That I would be set free. That you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life. That I would be set free. You've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
If you believe that this morning, say amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us here at Calvary today. If you see that QR code on the screen, I'd invite you to follow that through your phone to our link tree, and you'll be able to get a hold of the sermon notes, either in a printable form or the YouVersion app, and find those. They'll help you follow along with where we are going today. This morning, we are in the final sermon of our Joseph series. We began tracking this story with the birth of Joseph, and today we get to the other end of life when Joseph takes his final breath. Some time ago, I stumbled across a little video. It's a speed lapse of an artist rendition. I think it was titled The Passing of Time, and you'll see why that is here. Let me share. To me, that's some pretty phenomenal sketching ability. All, you know, speed lapsed forward in 23 seconds or so, but those 23 seconds kind of reflect how fast it feels like life moves. The older I get, the quicker it seems as though time flies, like the old phrase says. And that video seems more and more realistic every single day. The brevity of life always kind of crystallizes for me. This week we had a funeral here in our church for a dear lady. Her name was Barb Cooper. The Cooper family goes way back to the beginning of Calvary Baptist Church of Everett. Barb's father-in-law, Frank Cooper, was instrumental, was really a key leader in the founding of our church in 1945, 76 years ago. Barb was a teenager at the time in Barrington and unrelated to the Cooper family just yet, but eventually she married in, and for many, many years, along with her husband, Dwight, she was a pillar in many ministries here at Calvary Baptist Church. And we said goodbye for now to a lady this week that lived a long life. I learned a lot more about her in talking with family this week, and she had lived a life that was full of ups and quite a few challenges over her 90 years. But God gave her a long life. None of us know if we get that. None of us know how long we have here. The timing of the end of our days is fully in the hand of God. We've got no control over that particular date. But we do have an awful lot of influence over how prepared we are for when that day arrives. And that's kind of what I want to talk about with you this morning from Joseph's final days. If there's one thing about Joseph's life, which we've mentioned time and time again this summer, is that he had a whole bunch of things happen to him that were outside of his control, especially his first 30 years. Joseph dealt with incredible hardship, and yet he just kept going. He continued to trust God. He chose to forgive the wrongs that were done against him, and that recipe combined to give Joseph a legacy that I hope has been a blessing to you as we've looked at it up close over these past few months. And today we're just going to look at the last chapter. And so if you've got a Bible or the Bible app on your phone available, I would invite you to turn to Genesis chapter 50. And today we're going to start in verse 15. Now, there are some things that we skipped over, but only because we covered them in our study of Jacob a year ago. And if you're interested in those things, I would invite you to go back and watch the end of the Jacob series. Jacob blessed his 12 sons, and then he blessed Joseph's two sons as well. And then at the ripe old age of 147, Jacob died. His sons took him back to Canaan for a funeral and for burial. And it is immediately after that, immediately after dad's died and the funeral is passed, that Genesis chapter 50, verse 15 down through 18 take place. So follow along with me if you got a Bible there. It says, when Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?" So they sent word to Joseph saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. And it kind of leaves you wondering, well, what's Joseph going to do? Now, you probably already know the answer, but stop there for a minute and just think. Joseph's at an age when many guys go through sort of a midlife crisis and make some unusual decisions. And it wouldn't be too surprising if Joseph were to respond to this request by his brothers in a very normal way, a very natural way. Maybe he has just been waiting for dad to be gone to deal harshly with his brothers. But Joseph shows his real character in the way that he responds here. Joseph is not going to live as long as his dad, but he does still have 50 years or so in his life journey. I did the math this past week, and if I did it right, Joseph was likely right about my age, over the hill, but still hopefully with the finish line off in the distance a little ways. And the question is, well, how is Joseph going to finish? You know, how is Joseph going to finish the race that God has set before him? And you know, that's a question that translates to all of us, especially if you get a little bit later in your life journey. How do you run the later years of life in a way that you finish well? More importantly, how should a follower of Jesus finish and run that season of the race well? Joseph gives us some really challenging stuff in this. I want you to grab from this morning some traits. Joseph's life draws to a close, but it draws to a close with three key traits on very vivid display. And here's the first one. His commitment to forgiveness allowed him to avoid the trap of bitterness. Two big themes I placed over this entire series were the themes of faith and the theme of forgiveness. When Joseph was just 17 years old, his brothers so hated him, they plotted to kill him, then settled for selling him to slave traders that were heading to Egypt. And that dubious event started quite a downhill slide for Joseph in his experiences of life. For the next 13 years, life just headed fast downhill. And Joseph had to work through this process of forgiving his brothers for what they had started, what they had done in his life. Numerous times, as I've talked through this summer, I have shared a definition for forgiveness as a promise to release a debt that is owed, a promise to not remember sin done against us anymore. And as I have said before, that is not the same thing as forgetting. But it is intentionally choosing to not remember as the way to forgive. And that is forgiveness of the same caliber as God's forgiveness. Joseph started to work through that whole process when he named his first son. He gave his oldest the name Manasseh because Manasseh means God has helped me forget all of my troubles. And then he adds that, especially the troubles caused by my family. Later, after reuniting with them, Joseph has just demonstrated over and over again in this story that he had forgiven his brothers. And yet we come to this passage, and here we are 17 years later, 17 years afterward, that once dad is off the scene, it comes back one last time. These brothers bring it up this one last time, and yet you can't fully blame them. Maybe Joseph was just acting nice because of dad. And now dad's gone. He's finally going to give us what we really deserve. So they send this message purportedly from their father asking for forgiveness for their sins, for their wrongs. It's a very clear, maybe the clearest statement in the Joseph story by the brothers acknowledging what they had done to him was sinful and was wrong and needed to be forgiven. And when Joseph gets that message, it simply says Joseph wept. Now maybe he cried because they finally had verbalized the confession so clearly, maybe. But I think more likely Joseph wept that day because he realized that despite everything that he had said, everything that he had done, every outward demonstration that he had shown to his brothers that he had forgiven them, they still didn't believe it. They still didn't believe him. Now, true forgiveness of a deep-seated wrong is one of the most extraordinary things imaginable. True forgiveness, actual release of debt with no strings attached. That is kind of an extraordinary thing, almost an unbelievable event. But Joseph had done it. Joseph had taken that step. If it was uncertain in their minds, it was fixed firmly in his mind. He had chosen to forgive their sin many years before, and all along the way, and again you'll see it here, he's kept that promise. Now, if you stop and think about that a little bit, that does highlight, I think, a key point in how do you finish life well. The greatest things in life and the most challenging things in life are the relationships that God allows us to have over the course of our years. And sometimes those relationships, oftentimes those relationships, experience fracture, experience strain, experience situations in which there needs to be a promise given, hey, I forgive, and I'm going to keep that promise. If you're going to finish well, you need to be an individual who maintains that commitment. Because if you don't, the opposite is what I put in that first phrase. The opposite is walking straight into the trap of bitterness in your heart. Refusing to forgive plants the seed of bitterness that takes root, that spreads, that can infect a person's soul. And we've all seen it, and it's ugly when somebody has refused to forgive for so long that it turns them into just a bitter, harsh person. Corrie ten Boom was a dear lady that spent years in a concentration camp in Germany. She lost her family because they had tried to protect Jews was incarcerated in concentration camp by the Nazis. Just 12 days before her release, her sister Betsy, who was with her, died in the prison camp. She had a lot of reasons to hate the Nazis, a lot of reasons to be bitter. And yet one of the themes that resonated from Corrie's life after World War II and in her writings and in her speaking engagements was the theme of forgiveness. She often talked about it. And this is a quote from Corrie ten Boom. She said this, "Forgiveness is the key that unlocks the door of resentment and the handcuffs of hate. It is a power that breaks the chains of bitterness and the shackles of selfishness." Forgiveness. Forgiveness is so critical. It's so critical in living life well, and it's so critical in finishing life well. And Joseph had learned that. He'd learned it years before. He'd chosen to forgive his brothers, even if they didn't believe him, even if they thought it was unthinkable that somebody would do that. And it changed the way that he navigated life and moved toward the finish line. It allowed him to avoid the very common trap found in a bitter heart. Now go back to the verses where we stopped, and you can hear Joseph kind of say this himself. It says in verse 19, "But Joseph said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children.' And he reassured them, and he spoke kindly to them." Joseph was committed to forgiveness, the forgiveness that he didn't need to grant here because he granted it many, many years before. But that was built on a deeper foundation. Joseph had this rock solid faith in the fact that God was sovereignly in control of it all. And he tells his brothers, "You don't need to be afraid. I'm not God. You intended to harm me all those years ago, but God had a different plan. And I have, and I continue to trust in God." So here's my second trait. His faith in God's sovereign control allowed him to respond to life's difficulties with grace. It was Joseph's faith in God's sovereign control that allowed him to handle the evil done to him and respond to that in a different way, a gracious way, a forgiving way. And there's something very, very important to grasp in that. It's something that resonates through really the entire rest of the Bible. In the New Testament, it's so crystal. For instance, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus numerous times said, "Now you've heard it said this," or, you know, common people would think this way, "but I say to you, it ought to be different." And one of those has to do with this. You know, he said in the Sermon on the Mount, "Love your enemies." You know, you've heard it said that people should hate their enemies and love their friends. I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. That was unimaginable to think that anybody would do that. But that's what Jesus said. "I want my followers different." We easily love those who love us. We easily pray for those that we care about, but followers of Christ ought to be different. We ought to even love those that treat us wrong. My followers go further, and I want you to love those who hate you, love those who treat you poorly, love your enemies, and pray for those who do you wrong. That's what Jesus said. A little later in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul expanded it as well. The book of Romans, chapter 12, and verse 19, he wrote this, "Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge. I will repay,' says the Lord." Paul writes pretty clearly, you know, when you've been wronged, it's not your place to try and right that. God's in control. And the spiritually mature way to approach and navigate through life is to leave room for God's wrath and trust righting wrongs to Him. That's God's territory, not mine. And then two verses later, he said this, very similar to what Jesus said, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Joseph lived those verses thousands of years before Paul wrote them. He refused to take revenge on his brothers, even when he had the motive and even when he had the means, quite much so, to mete out revenge. Instead, repeatedly, he heaped the blessings. He responded to evil with good. He provided for their needs, took care of their families in ways that none of them deserved. But Joseph did it. He overcame evil with good. He responded to their evil with tremendous good. And if you ask why, it was simply because he says here, he recognized, he believed honestly and from the depths of his heart that God had been behind all of that. That God was completely in control of the unfolding events of his life. And that faith in God's sovereignty allowed him to respond to life's difficulties with grace. Which does kind of connect with another verse, just a few chapters earlier in the book of Romans, that you've probably heard before. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. 2,000 years before Paul wrote those words, Joseph believed those words. He encountered hardship after hardship at the hands of his own siblings, but he believed with a conviction. They did not do this on their own. It is all part of God's plan. He's going to work good through it. And one day, he came to be able to see clearly what all of that meant. Verses 20 and 21 there with Joseph's words are some of the most grace-filled, amazing words in Joseph's story. But they also give a recipe, I think, for running well right to the finish line. Instead of bitterness, forgive, and then respond with grace by three things. Leaving the righting of wrongs to God. Joseph says, don't be afraid. I'm not in the place of God. That's God's role to right the wrongs. Leaving the righting of wrongs to God. Responding to evil with good. Joseph says, I'm going to provide for you. I'm provide for your children. I'm going to be a blessing to you, even though you intended it harm towards me. And right in the middle, right, packaged in the center of all of that is his conviction that he realized God was behind it and God is bringing good through his overarching plan. Life's full of broken moments. Last year, I shared the website McBroken.com. Some techie kid designed a website that reverse engineers the McDonald's app to determine whether the ice cream machine is down at that particular location or not. The day that I checked on this, one of Cadillac's McDonald's machines were down, but we're good to go here in Everett. Kind of interesting, the statistics on the side, almost 12% of ice cream machines at McDonald's around the country were down at the particular time. And it is kind of humorous that somebody would take the time, you know, to design all of that. But it did not go unnoticed by the government. And I only bring it back up today because 2 weeks ago, there was a news report that the FTC has begun investigating why the ice cream machines at McDonald's are notorious for being broken. And the government's getting involved, and I'm sure that will definitely make things better. But you know, life is full of broken things. We all experience it so often. Broken people, broken situations, it's just part of life. You're not going to avoid that. You're not going to get away from that. But you do have to decide, how are you going to respond to it? How do you respond to the broken things in your life? Believing that God is in control and sovereignly in charge of everything that happens, that lets some of the steam off when brokenness comes close to home for us. And I want to encourage you to realize this today. I can respond with grace to broken things if we hold tightly to this belief that God is in control, that God is in charge, that God does have a plan. He knows what he's doing, and I can trust him. Even though it feels broken right now, I can trust God right now in what I'm going through. Now, verse 22, the very next verse, it jumps ahead 50 years. Joseph lived a long life. He would die at the age of 110. The final verses of the book of Genesis tell that part of Joseph's story. But they also give us one last trait, and I just share this if you're filling in blanks. That third trait is his confidence in God's promises allowed him to face death with a forward-looking certainty, a forward-facing certainty. Verse 22, Joseph stayed in Egypt along with all of his father's family. He lived 110 years and saw the third generation of Ephraim's children. Also, the children of Machir, son of Manasseh, were placed at birth on Joseph's knees. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "I am about to die, but God will surely come to your aid and take you up out of this land to the land he promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." And Joseph made the Israelites swear an oath and said, "God will surely come to your aid, and then you must carry my bones up from this place." Joseph died at the age of 110, and after that, after they embalmed him, he was placed in a coffin in Egypt. 50 years go by. For 50 years, Joseph was a steady force in Egypt. There's no details given as to his role, how it continued, but he was blessed with the gift of grandchildren and great-grandchildren and even great-great-grandchildren. He lived a long life. But his last request there, it does seem a little odd, doesn't it? Why would he make his family swear to take his bones with them and then bury his bones in the land of promise when they returned there? And the answer, I think, is simply this, that Joseph wanted his kids, his brothers, his nephews, you know, nieces, he wanted this entire family, the next generation and the next generation and the next generation after that, he wanted them to keep looking forward to the fulfillment of God's promises. Now, he had no way of knowing that that wouldn't happen for 400 years. But he knew it would happen. And he knew it happened for one reason. God had said it would happen. God had not given Egypt to the family of Abraham as their land of promise. God had given them Canaan. And Joseph knew that at some point along the line, God was going to take them back there. And when they did, he wanted to be buried in the land of promise to his fathers. Joseph knew that although he would soon pass from the scene, God would never pass from the scene. And so he points his whole family forward. Hey, keep looking that way. Keep looking forward. And twice he reminds them, because God will surely come to your aid. Keep looking forward. Trust God every single step of the way. Even when at the doorway of death, he says this. Keep looking forward. There's more to come because God will surely come to your aid. I don't think anybody really likes to think about death. I saw a piece in the news this past week. Jeff Bezos of Amazon fame is one of the primary funders of a project seeking to discover the secrets of eternal life. That's the headline there. Funds the quest for eternal life. And Jeff has put millions of dollars into a project that's called Alto Labs, which is exploring gene reprogramming as a way to prevent aging and attempt to discover how to live forever. And I hate to tell him, but Jeff is looking in the wrong place. God's word has made it very clear that every person lives forever. There is a life past this life for every person. The location, though, is determined by our faith or our absence of faith in God. As the remainder of the scriptures made very clear, God's answer to the problem of death infecting and affecting every one of us, that answer came in the form of God's only Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus took on human flesh. Also, he could die a death in our place and defeat death once and for all. And he rose to new life as a victory statement, but also this bold promise that eternal life in God's presence is available for every person who will choose to believe in him. And you can have confidence, just like Joseph had confidence. God will surely come to your aid. You can have forward-looking confidence, even at the doorway of death, because of Jesus Christ. I hope you have that this morning. I hope you know that today, that you've put your faith in Jesus Christ alone. Because it changes life now, but it most importantly changes the life past this life to be so much better. In a way, it's kind of sad for me to come to the end of a study through the life of Joseph. I've enjoyed this journey. I hope that you've learned some things as we've walked along together. But coming to the close, there's just so many themes that are important to wrap up with. But I want to close with this last illustration. Earlier this summer, I read a book on the life of Homer Roadheaver, and maybe that name doesn't sound familiar to you, but if you've done anything with Christian music over the years, it probably does sound vaguely familiar. Roadheaver was a pioneer in the Christian music industry. He launched one of the first gospel music recording companies. He started Roadheaver Publishers, which produced tons of hymn books through the 20th century. Was eventually bought out by Word Music, one of the big conglomerates that's still around today. Roadheaver owned the rights to the hymn, The Old Rugged Cross. And for us here in Everett, there's a local connection to The Old Rugged Cross because Reed City is where the original author retired. Roadheaver owned the rights to that song, that hymn. He was behind the marketing of it in such a way that it became very familiar and a song that everyone in Christianity today still knows. He came to fame as the song leader with a trombone for Billy Sunday in the heyday of the Crusade movement. Lived a very interesting life, lived a very full life, and it was an interesting book to read. Near the end of Roadheaver's life, he took a stab at, a very short-lived stab, but he took a stab at writing an autobiography. And the final page of the book that I read on his life, it said this about the autobiography. It said, only a typewritten chapter survives, where he looks at his own life and remembers a fragment of wisdom from long ago that most lives are second bests. True success, Roadheaver explained, would have been his original career goal, becoming a lawyer. But then, after he types the paragraph, he scrawls an interrupting note in the margin, but destiny or God ruled otherwise. I love that little statement by Roadheaver. He got to the end of his days, he looked back on all that he had experienced, all the things that God had, I would say, accomplished through him. And realize, you know what, I had this vision when I started life, going one direction, but God ruled otherwise. That's probably a byline all of us could scrawl over some segment of our lives. It definitely could be scrawled over the life story of Joseph. As a favorite son of a doting dad, he never could have imagined the future that would unfold before him. Likely he, or at least his father, envisioned that one day Joseph would take over the family shepherding business and run all of that so well and lead his family that way. But God ruled otherwise. God took Joseph's life through twists and turns, through downs and then ups. Periods when he had to trust God deeply just to survive, and times when he had to forgive his brothers completely in order to keep moving forward. God ruled otherwise. And in the end, Joseph's life was a life that leaves a legacy. Which brings me to a natural way to conclude this series in asking this question, well, what about What about you? What about you? Joseph finished his race well. As a man of faith and a man of forgiveness. But I think we got to ask the question often. What about me? How strong are you finishing your race? Just like that time-lapse video I showed at the very beginning of the sermon, life goes by so quickly. You only get so many opportunities to keep relationships healthy and to grow in your faith in God. You only get so many opportunities before the finish line shows up over the horizon. Time goes by so very fast. And you have to be prepared for that. Joseph was ready. He was ready to die because he was a man of faith and forgiveness. And I would hope today you could say the same. If not, if there are areas to change in your life, today'd be a really good day to get started on that, to make those kind of changes. I find one last thing just very intriguing about how this whole story ends. The book of Genesis closes by pointing beyond Joseph's story. It points really to the story every one of us need to experience. Genesis began with God creating this perfect paradise for the human race, but it ends with a dead hero in a coffin. That vividly reflects what sin's entrance in chapter number 3 of Genesis brought into the human experience. But it doesn't end there. It doesn't end there. The twice stated line, God will surely come to your aid, I think that spans much further than just the next book in Exodus. One day, 2,000 years later, God would surely come to their aid, to your aid, to my aid, when God himself, in the person of Jesus Christ, came here to save us all. He was born of a virgin, he lived a perfect life, and then he willingly died on the cross for the sins of every single person who had ever lived and would ever live. And that includes you, and that includes me. He surely came to our aid, because in his death, his burial, his resurrection, Jesus solved the curse of sin that hangs over us all. He took what we deserve so we could have hope, so we could have eternal life. And none of us, you don't need to fear death. You can look past that to eternal relationships with God and with others that know him, if you've responded in faith to God's answer, Jesus Christ, who died for you. If you've not done that yet, I would invite you, as we close this series, to today settle that most important issue and be sure that you are ready to finish your race well. Hey, bow your heads. Let's pray together and wrap this all up. Father God, I thank you so much for what we've been able to learn and think about as we walk through this section of your word and studying the life of Joseph this summer. And this morning, you know, we look at how it all ended. At the end of a life is a sobering thing, but it also ought to be a challenging thing for us to look inward and reflect on the decisions that we have made, the directions that we are heading, and how we are moving towards our finish line. It will come for every single one of us. And the question is, are we ready for that? And are we doing the kind of things today in keeping relationships strong, in trusting in you as we journey through the ups and downs of life, and in most importantly, of responding to your answer, to responding to Jesus, who came here to surely rescue us all. Father, every one of us have a brief period of time left to run. And my prayer is today, we'll consider, how about me? How am I running? Am I finishing well? And if we need to make decisions today, take steps today, give us the courage, give us the commitment to follow through and take the next step in our faith journey. In Jesus' name I pray.